earned her BA in Visual Communication Design from Federal University of Rio de Janeiro in 2015, and then joined the Painting Graduate Program at the University of Alberta the following year. During her years of study, she's had her painting shown in galleries in Toronto, Edmonton, and in the US. Her current research tackles feminine identity and body image through the perspective of a woman of color brought up in a very strict patriarchal society that worships the able, heterosexual, cis, thin body as the ultimate goal for women. Using the medium of painting and photography, she creates self-portraits as a tool to explore the boundaries of women's worth, body positivity, somatic healing, and body diversity. So please welcome to you.
Thank you, Brandy. I swear I'm going to try not to swear during this talk, but so thank you for the introduction. I was going to talk just about my research, but I think talking about my journey as a graduate student over the past 2 years that I've been here, I think it's going to be better for you guys to understand kind of what led me to investigate and research what I'm researching right now. And so this is a tale of resilience, a focus of courage, and I'm honored to be able to share this journey with you guys today. So I wanted to start by telling you guys a little bit about what I was doing before I joined the program. So I got my degree in graphic design back home in Brazil in 2015, and I was working as a concept artist and illustrator during my undergrad. I also founded my own game studio startup, which I absolutely love, was the best thing I ever did. But because of how economy is in Brazil, we had to close down, and down here. During my undergrad, I also did some exchange studies in Florida. I spent a year there doing installation art using game software. So that was pretty freaking cool. And I got that on a scholarship. So that kind of opened my eyes. I'm like, hey, you know, I'm not as dumb as I thought. So maybe I could, you know, try and apply for a program outside. And I always wanted to live anywhere outside of Brazil. So I applied to a bunch of places, and I got accepted to a bunch of them. And the only place that accepted me that had a painting, not visual arts, not, you know, any interdisciplinary, just painting, was the University of Alberta. And I was like, yes, this is what I want to do. Painting, just 100% painting, no fiddling, right? Like, I really want to understand that medium. And I actually put on my acceptance letter, hey, I don't know how to paint, but I would love to do this, right? One of the reasons why I hadn't had that practice before is because art supplies are very expensive in Brazil, and so that kind of led me, and because of my design background as well, I ended up learning a bunch of the things that I knew on my own using a tablet and a computer, and I mean, it was better for the anxiety as well, because, you know, oh, you failed a painting and you just spent like $100 worth of paint. Wow. No. So when I got accepted into the program here, I actually had this idea that I was going to continue doing what I was doing before. I was just going to learn how to paint, and it was going to be great, and all those things. So I got here, and well, I was told that I wasn't going to be doing what I was doing before, that I should be doing something new. And that made me very confused in the beginning, right? So I got into the program, I didn't know how to paint. I was in the painting program, and I was supposed to do nothing that I was doing before. So it was really overwhelming in the beginning. I was very lucky because in the beginning I was much more interested in kind of the technical physical material aspect of painting, so I kind of delved right into that. So I started doing figure paintings and still lives, and I was teaching a painting fundamentals class that I'm teaching right now, so hi students. And so I was learning a lot at that time, but I wasn't really thinking about concept or thinking about, hey, you know, like I'm making images and now I need to, you know, give them some sort of meaning. No, I was just like looking at a lot of Velasquez and Rubens and all those guys that, oh my God, please, I want to paint like you. I was looking at those guys and I was trying to figure out how they were doing what they're doing, right? But I didn't have any of the mark-making vocabulary that, you know, somebody that usually does an undergrad in painting has, right? So I had to really catch up. So I was doing a lot of different things at the same time. I was painting from life. I was literally bribing my TA students to pose for me in exchange for donuts. So that was a thing. And it ended up being interesting because I was alone in a very cold country with very different people, and I had no friends. So that was the best thing that I could have done, so I could actually begin to form those connections. And that's a big, big part of graduate studies, and that has shaped my research in ways that I couldn't have anticipated before, right? So, sorry if I'm going too fast, and if I can drink something. So, during that time that I was intensely, I was painting every day, I was painting for long, long hours, and out of all the practices that I have been undertaken, self-portraiture was definitely the one that left the deepest mark. It was a very uncomfortable practice for me, and it was the end of fall 2016, and I have to do a manifesto for a class, and I began to notice that having those two practices at the same time, painting myself and painting other people, I began to notice a discrepancy in the way that I was enduring looking at myself, and that was in the way that I was looking at other people. Right? So those two practices were at odds with each other, right? So I had this idea, and I waited at the time, but it was a very good, happy accident. I put up all my work in my studio, like the photos are showing there, and I got some post-its, and I wrote down on my pictures, on my portraits, everything that I had thought, or even said, or even heard from my family and from people that are close to me, things about myself, things that people think about when they look at myself, and I did the same thing with people that I had painted, the things that I were seeing in them, right? So, yeah. So, and then I had people come in into my studio, and I just told them, it was kind of a fun experiment thing, hey, like, can come in, you can do anything, you can do anything with the post-its, I'm curious to see what you guys are going to do. And I was very surprised and really emotional when I saw that they were able to find love from the hate, and they were able to offer me a different perspective that I couldn't see myself, right? And that experience left me puzzled. And so when winter started, I was like, okay, maybe I'm onto something here. Yes, it's painful. Yeah, it's uncomfortable. But you know, let's see where that takes me. And so I kind of left this to the side a little bit. Went back into technique because that's my comfort zone. That's what I'm really interested in about. And so I was reading a lot of books on Titian, Rubens, and Velasquez, and I was developing a series of three paintings at the same time. And I was really interested in the way that material serves the amount of paint that you should apply to the canvas to give that aspect of believability, right? So one thing allied to the other, form allied to content, right? Description of nature. So that was something that I was looking at. And before I was doing some portraits, I was painting with acrylic only, which I hate right now, so I can't even. But as I became more familiar with oils, and through dedicated practice and determination, I was finally able to create some sort of vocabulary that enabled me to look at these words and be like, hey, this guy is doing this. He's glazing, he's scumbling, he's scraping, he's, you know. So that really helped me in my research, because in my mind I was like, hey, I not only want to paint like this person, I want to deconstruct what they're thinking about, how they're thinking, and I want to apply it to my own work. I think everybody wants to do under research, right? So meanwhile, I was being encouraged by my supervisors to start exploring conceptual ideas inside my imagery. It was basically like halfway through the winter, and they were like, okay, you're just doing the same thing, like let's push you in another direction a little bit, because I mean, if it was up to me, I'm just doing the same thing, so I'm thankful for them in that sense. And so I started exploring imagery. I was looking at a lot of kind of narrative imagery, especially with Velázquez, and I was trying to think about an idea to translate what I was feeling when I was doing self-portraits, right? That was kind of my idea at the time. And because of my background as an illustrator, it was a very difficult challenge for me not being literal, right? So sometimes what works in an illustration might not make a good piece of fine art. So yeah, lesson learned. So this was kind of the first. There's a third painting, but it sucks, so I didn't include it in there. So over the course of several weeks, I developed a set of three paintings, two of which I'm showing on the slide, and I'm using the Venetian technique. So I was reading a lot of books. I was really intrigued by how they were doing what they were doing with paint. And I was taken by the idea of victims perpetuating cultural abuse. So because I'm from Brazil, I know too well just how much, as a woman, we have to carve, sculpt, distort, and hurt ourselves just to fit in into a dystopic idea of what a woman is, right? So I began asking myself, is this who I am? Is this who I am perpetuating the cycle of abuse I was submitted to growing up? Can I be victim and executioner at the same time? More importantly, am I consenting to this abuse? Do I take any pleasure out of it? Those were questions I was interested in at the time, and I had a midterm critique around that time, though was a little bit problematic at the time. The work was creating a lot of emotional response in some of the viewers, and although it really intrigued me, I could have handled it better at that time to really try and understand why that was happening, and I became afraid and thought, okay, maybe I shouldn't go to this route. Let's let this idea rest. And it was the summer at the time, so I decided to take some drawing courses and, you know, hone up those skills, because what are you gonna do? And I decided to put oil painting on the side for a while, focus on some more fantasy stuff, go back to my comfort zone, and go back into research. So I was introduced during the summer of 2017. I came across Jenny Saville's work, and I became enamored by the scale, the rawness of her portraits, and I was also fascinated by the sense of distortion and flashiness that her paintings paintings evoked. So, you know, I was interested in talking about the body, right? So I couldn't really talk about the body without looking at her work and referencing that. So scale, which was something that I was not really considering at the time, became one of the things that I was kind of trying to juggle with the things that I was doing. I also, because I was painting from life a lot, one of my profs introduced me to the work of Lucian Freud, which I didn't know before. I know, crazy, right? His paintings really clicked with me in terms of depiction of physical body in the way that he aligns the application of paint with the rawness, the disgust that the physical body evokes. And that was something that really fascinated me, because he's, to me, like, he's going a step further than guys like, you know, Rubens and Velazquez are going. It's not necessarily about representing reality, it's about representing the psychological effect of the real, right? So I was like, yes, you know, that's starting to make sense. All those pieces are starting to fit together in a weird way. So I kept pushing, I kept researching. I also came across this guy's work. His name is Benjamin Bjorklund. And I was fascinated by his work and the way that he handles oil painting and watercolor at the same time, and how he uses pigment. I don't know exactly how to explain, but it's very, like, you wouldn't think to work in this way. Like, some areas you would probably think to make thick and he makes thin. Like, it's a very unpredictable work to me. And I was like, oh, okay. And he was using watercolor, right? And I was feeling very, very frustrated. Very frustrated with my oil painting at the time. And I was like, okay, well, maybe I'll pick up a watercolor set and see kind of what comes out of there. Like I was feeling desperate, you know? And I was trying to please my supervisors as well. So I was like, okay, that's it. They want me to experiment? I'll experiment. That's fine. And just an FYI, there's nudity on the next slide, like photographic nudity. So, yeah. So, and another thing that people were, like, people doing studio visits in my studio and stuff were telling me is like, hey, you're a digital painter. Hey, you know photography, you know all those things. How come you're not using that in your work? Like, use it. You know, like, don't fight against the things that you already know, right? So I took the advice to heart, and I decided to explore that a little bit. And I was heavily influenced by the way that Jenny Saville was structuring her paintings. At the time, I was heavily referencing that with the photographs. And at that time, I was trying to conceive the idea of bondage maybe being a metaphor for the psychological restraint and the patriarchy, but I ended up kind of leaving that idea behind. But I really like the distortion of the body, like, that stuck with me. I thought that felt right. So I kept on exploring, and I decided to work on the watercolors. And the way that I dealt with these is I treated them like sketches. I would pump out sometimes 10 in a day, and I would just like take them to the same board, and I would just like pump them like crazy. And one of the reasons why I would do that is because I really didn't think people were going to like it or whatever. I was just trying to do something new without any expectation. And turned out that some things were really successful, and it kind of informed the way that I was dealing with my oil painting later as well. So by kind of going in a different direction, kind of led me back onto my path in a way that I wasn't expecting, right? So giving yourself chances to explore things like that. friendship, this friendship happening without myself knowing. And I kind of wanted to push the activist aspect of it. So I decided to just go on Facebook and look for a bunch of body positivity and fat positive groups. And I started posting my work there and talking about my research. And I said, well, you know, I love painting people. If you're okay with posing for me, you know, we can do a studio visit and let's, you know, chat over coffee or whatever, right? And weirdly, people actually responded and people were excited to participate, and they had very different points of view. So I started painting, you know, queer people, trans people, men, women, everybody sharing those experiences about the same topic. It gave me a lot of insight. It gave me a lot of confidence in talking about the things that I was talking about. And, you know, and that actually happens when you're researching and things. Sometimes you don't notice something in your process unless you have to talk about it. And then it becomes clear, right? So, and I also want to thank, because there's actually somebody that posed for me here today. Thanks, Lauren. all right, so once I had that kind of figured out, I had a direction in terms of concept of what I was doing. I started to go back and look at a lot of Benjamin Bjorklund and thinking about the application of paint and how I was going to try and achieve a similar thing to what he was doing. So instead of thinking about the material as, am I going to make this believable, it became more a matter of, how much material do I need to put on the surface to make this person feel that, right? So the focus changed a little bit, right? And of course, as every beginner student, I was also skimping on paint. I wasn't painting with enough paint. And so, that's a learned. And so I started to kind of push the spectrum. Very, very thin, very, very thick. Why not have both, right? So again, several attempts to push thickness and transparency on the portrait. I was also like trying to work my drawing. And I was kind of trying to play with staging and trying to understand the model through props and the way that the gaze, the way that they're posed, right? At the same time, like all those things are kind of happening concomitantly. So I was also still doing the self-portraits, but I was much more kind of taken by the way that I was applying the paint. And I was also interested in the way that I was going to repeat imagery, right? Because I was reading, So I'm reading a lot of Freud, and I was reading also from my personal perspective. When you're dealing with trauma, it might be triggered by the same event, but the feeling is going to be different. So I wanted to allude to that when I'm repeating the same imagery in several different paintings. Right. So after, as we continue this, you'll see that I keep trying to push that. I was also trying to push scale, so I started doing bigger, more complex watercolors, as well as oil paintings. And during the winter 2018, yes, winter 2018, yes, sorry, I'm lost in time, I actually went to Paris for a week. And that was completely, it was absolutely incredible. It completely changed the way that I understood paint. It completely forms and tools and trying to abstract, think about the figure in much more of an abstract term. Especially one of the issues that I ran into as I scaled up the work is that there wasn't enough material for people to engage in the surface, right? Sometimes a picture works when they're small, but they don't necessarily work when they're big. So how can you make those two readings work at the same time, right? So that was something that was on my mind when I was doing those. That and the idea of, I really wanted to surround the viewer with like a triptych, like three paintings of the same subject matter painted in different ways, and I wanted to see what that did, right? And at the time, I took what I learned when I was doing the watercolor painting, and I used water to scratch my canvases. These were sketches. They were disposable, they were immediate, and they were worthless, right? And I feel like that really helped me explore and carry on to things. Like I've cut canvases, I've pushed myself not to think of it as a body, as an object, and much more as an idea, as clay for me to mold, right? So these are just some detail shots, just to kind of clarify a little bit of what I was thinking about with having, you know, a very thick passage and a very transparent passage very close to each other, and thinking about those contrasting terms, but instead of thinking about, hey, this is a hand, or hey, this is a face, it's much more about, hey, as an abstract painting, does this work? Right, so having those two layers at the same time. Yes, so again, those are some close-ups of the painting, and I just wanted to show how that different parts of it are treated, and it didn't become a result of the process, it became intentional. Another one. And I also wanted to, again, experiment with the triptychs, and that's something that I'm still working on. They're all in progress too. and so I had these ideas. I had the digital composites of myself, and then I thought, what happens if I actually do that with the model, right? Because I was painting the models from life before, but what happens if I actually introduce that digital layer in the process? And not only that, instead of having them come to my studio and react to whatever is there, to me, my energy, my space, what happens if I actually go to their house? I bring my stuff to their house and set up in there. What kind of difference can I have in terms of posing, in terms of storytelling, in terms of emotion? And so I decided to try and do that. And I went to the model's house. I took pictures there. I took a lot of pictures. I didn't direct the model at all. We had a very long conversation. I took pictures in the meantime, and I would ask them questions. I would ask them questions such as, which part of your body are you most uncomfortable about? When you're on the street and somebody catcalls you, how does that make you feel? When you see somebody that has, when you see a photoshopped image of somebody who's just perfect, how does that make you feel? And so instead of trying to direct the model 100%, I'm collaborating with them. I am making those composites and I am sharing them with them, because I believe that I don't have ownership of their story. And even though I am trying to connect with them and I'm trying to tell our story together, I don't believe it would be fair for me to just interpret fleshiness of the body. And then I would paint the picture, right? And I've been asked this many times, why not just, you know, have the photographs instead? Like, the photographs look okay. Like, why do I have to paint the pictures, right? For me, and I think it works even better for when it's the model, it's my hand, it's my creation of something that does not exist into the real world. And when I have the picture, when I have the composite that looks real because it's based off of photographs, it's the whole premise of photography. Oh, it's a photograph, it looks real, right? But there's a difference between real and looking whole. And I think if I'm trying to talk about the psychology of trauma, I have to go with believable instead of real. yes, so those are some close-ups of the work in progress. And I am also kind of working on and off with a smaller scale work. So my idea, now that I have my show kind of planned on in May, I want to have those kind of smaller, more sketchy works like these, and larger scale works like that, like this one. And I want to have the colorful and the dark, the thin and the thick, the variety of expression inside the same show, because I don't think I own a specific way that we react to trauma. And I think as a painter, it's not only important for me to show the breadth of my ability, but I need to consider my public, and I want people to relate to what I'm talking about. And I want people to have the breadth so we can actually have a conversation, because I really believe that, you know, when an image is powerful enough to get you talking about something, talking to other people, finding that community is the best way to find healing, right? And that's what kind of what I want my show to do. I want people to talk about it, to talk about their trauma, and them to bond, basically, to find kinship in pain. So just these are all works in progress, and I'm going to show just the last one, just my crown jewel, which is this one. Still a work in progress, but I'm very happy with where it's going. So that's basically where I am with my research, and I would love to talk to people more about that and connect. Yes. I'm just going to put on the last slide, and thank you. Yay.
On your bit of a backstory, those images that you showed, those were digital images?
The photographs?
No, the when you said a bit of a backstory and showed those.
Oh, yeah, those are all images.
Tablet.
Yeah, those are all digital, yeah. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And so those are paintings, but they're done digitally.
Yeah. And I guess the biggest challenge for me when I was transitioning, understanding the difference between the layering process in digital and the layering process in terms of paint. For example, when I started working with oil, I would just oversaturate the surface really quickly, because in Photoshop you can just be laying color on top of color on top of color. It doesn't matter if you screw it up, and in oil you just create mud. So
yeah. And so you don't feel there was any real transfer of knowledge from the digital realm to the IRL?
Well, I would say in terms of fundamentals of understanding, like, okay, what is a hard edge, what is a soft edge, color combinations and things like that. Yes, there was definitely some direct translation. The X of the question is just trying to figure out that, you know, you mix yellow and blue and, you know, you get green. Like, instead of just selecting a color in the color picker, right? You have to actually think about those relationships and the limitations of your pigments, so that what we call the color gamut, right? So, yeah, so that was something that I had to definitely learn.
So your work in the digital realm always stayed in RGB, or did you ever convert to CMYK?
Well, I printed some stuff before, but what ends up happening is I painted my RGB, I converted, and then I repainted.
In CMYK.
Yeah, but the problem with CMYK is that some functions of Photoshop actually don't work in CMYK. So.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah, some filters.
Yeah, some filters. Doing that before anything happens.